Hey everyone, today's mini bits and pieces episode is one that you don't want to miss. I'm talking to the one and only Mads Kristensen. He's a developer legend, Visual Studio mastermind, and keynote speaker at this year's Live 360 conference. Hey everyone, I've got Mads here who's going to share some secrets on building software that users actually love. Plus, we're going to be diving into why you should attend Live 360 and maybe even tabs versus spaces. So grab your coffee and let's get into it. Hey Mads, welcome to the show.
Thanks, April. Good to be here.
Really glad to have you here as well. And I heard you're giving a keynote at Live 360. Now, this will be your first time on this stage. And there's going to be over 1,500 attendees from over 20 countries in attendance. It's a big year. So are you nervous?
Yeah, I guess a little bit. I'm always a little bit nervous, which helps me kind of stay focused and, give me some energy. It's more like an excitement, I'd say. But whether it's 1,500 people or 5,000 or 50 people, it's very similar in experience to me, at least. And I still get a little nervous, still get butterflies, but in the end, it helps.
Yeah. So no pressure. You'll be fine.
Yeah, I'll be fine. Yeah.
Awesome. So tell us how you're getting ready. Are there any secret rituals or do you just drink a lot of coffee?
A lot of coffee, a lot of rehearsing. I usually rehearse to my a plant or something in the room, walk around, make sure the timing is all right. Make sure that I don't talk about things that don't really belong in the story that I'm trying to tell. And so that can sometimes be hard because we think when we talk about our own products, our own software, or our own experiences, it's very easy to fall into the pit of like, over-indexing on some details that are maybe not that important to get the message across. And so it's like, by just keep going and rehearsing and practicing and make sure the flow is there, those things kind of align slowly over time. So it's all about preparation.
Absolutely. And practice. So you're going to have a huge global and diverse audience with a lot of people, whether they're developers, IT pros, data and cybersecurity pros. What excites you most about such diversity in your audience?
Well, what's really cool about Live 360 is, as you're saying, it's like it has all these different professions in one room. And I'd love to hear from everybody. So the reason I love going to conferences like this one is to get all this feedback, get new ideas, get inspired, but have these hallway conversations after the fact. That like changes things because what often happens is that you hear from people you don't normally hear from. Like I hear a lot of from people that are on Twitter that reaches out, right? Or that write me emails or through our bug tracking systems or something like that. I have conversations with a relative small group of people that does that. But the vast majority of our users don't do that, but they do come to events like this. And so getting the insights from them there is absolutely invaluable. And it's a lot of fun too.
Amazing. Now I heard that your keynote topic is called building lovable software for millions of users. So what inspired you to choose this topic?
Well, what happened was that in the last 14 years that I've been in the developer division at Microsoft, so the developer division, we make all kinds of software that are used by millions of people, like from Visual Studio, VS Code, and a lot more products. And what I've seen over time is sometimes we got things wrong. And like about a year ago, we were looking at, hey, there's something here that doesn't seem right and we need to do something about. And we started this journey to like basically take a step back and look ourselves in the mirror and rethink a lot of things. And we learned a lot and we made mistakes, right? And we got some lessons on how to do things the right way. And so I want to just share that journey and share with everybody because there's nothing here that's unique to Microsoft, to developer division, to Visual Studio, and to any of these other products. It really is like kind of universal things. And I can't take credit for all these ideas. A lot of them come from, books that I've been reading and so on. But it's how did it in practice unfold within our organization, how our thoughts and thinking about building product has changed and still is changing. It's an ever evolving thing, right? And so it's, to me, it's very interesting because having done this for 14 years, having been down different paths, and now it seems like finally finding like something that really, really resonates with our users is something worth sharing and something that has value to a lot of people, hopefully.
It sounds like there's going to be some really good takeaways in your talk, mm-hmm. and you've given us some really good sneak peeks into what we can expect. So you're a longtime leader in the development community. What's one thing that you think you've learned from interacting with developers that you plan to bring to your keynote?
Well, one thing is listening. So, you know, this is something we've said that we are doing all the time. And you probably see this, right? We're people listening, like different companies listening, sending surveys. Hey, tell us what you think. Give us feedback. Give us a rating. How did you like this feature? *1-5, right? But on the other end of those surveys and that data, are people actually using it? Are they actually listening to what it maybe isn't being said? And I think that is one of the key things that I've come to realize is that doing all this survey and user research is not necessarily the same as truly listening. And I have some great examples of how that shows up and how that becomes issues, but also then how can we then easily turn that around and start listening for real? And it has to do with showing respect to users. It has to do with aligning goals, like business goals and user goals, which sometimes conflict, right? They're not always aligned. And so how do we align those goals so that we can have true win-win situations? And and so there's a lot of stuff here from the trenches over the years that we can, that I'm going to bring up and use as examples.
Yeah. And it sounds like your experience in shaping Visual Studio has been paramount into shaping this keynote and really improving that developer experience. So the people that are attending, how is going to help developers enhance their own tools and their own workflows?
Yeah, right. So there's nothing here specific about in this keynote for just developers using Visual Studio. It really is for everybody that builds product, whether that's a product that's public facing or internal facing. So a lot of IT admins, for instance, their customer is an internal customer, right? But the same principles apply. And when we started looking at applying the same principles that we do to building public features to building internal features, we're going to see a whole different things happening inside and how that permeates throughout the whole organization and changes the culture and actually affects the public features in the long term. And it's really interesting how that's all connected. We're going to talk about security, what we're doing there, data, and a bunch of different topics that I think will immediately be very applicable to anyone in the audience.
So always with conferences, people always have to kind of weigh out the pros and cons of, you know, leaving their family, taking some time off work potentially, or maybe their work is sponsoring it. So the people that are coming that are maybe on the fence thinking about, should I attend or should I not? What benefit do you think an event like Live 360 brings to them, to their careers and their personal growth?
Mm-hmm. Well, I think there are several things. So of course, one is that you come and you hear from like industry leaders. You get a bunch of questions answered in all these different sessions and keynotes throughout the week at the conference. But that's just one side of it, kind of the educational side, if you will. What I personally have always loved about conferences is the things that are unscheduled, right? So that's the things that happens in the hallways. It's between the sessions. It's at the parties in the evenings, at the dinners. It's that you get to meet and sit face to face with someone that you know from, you know, online or old colleagues or someone you don't know. And especially when we have these table conversations that we do have, where you go sit down at the table, it has like a topic listed, and you want to say, yeah, I want to go talk about AI, or I want to go talk about SQL Server Management Studio, right? Or whatever the topic might be, cybersecurity. And then other like-minded people go to that same table and you have lunch together and you don't know each other when you begin, but you do when you end. And it's a fantastic experience. You get to learn so many things about other people, how they work, you get to harness the experience of so many people that you otherwise, you just, there's no way you would really do that in any other circumstance than going to these conferences. So to me, that's really the power of a conference like Live 360.
Absolutely. It sounds like the resounding answer is don't just stand at the snack bar or stand by yourself in the corner. Go interact, go see people. And also there's going to be some really amazing hands-on labs. And like you said, networking opportunities after the after stuff, the kind of meal times and all that. How important, I mean, I think you really touched on how important the in-person experience is, but how about like the hands-on experience? What are the benefits people get hands-on with some of the latest stuff out there? How's that going to help their career?
That changes a lot of things, because when you go and you go to a session, a regular session where you sit down and listen to a presenter, you are going to have a topic that might be new to you. They're going to demystify it. Like, here's what it is, why you would want to use it. And it's great, right? And you might be left with that notion that, hey, this is something I should look into.
Absolutely.
So there's a lot of value there. Now, if you contrast that to the full day workshops, for instance, that takes it just a whole nother step, you know, where you really go and you try it hands-on, you get a feel for it. So the session can demystify it, but what you don't get from the session is the hands-on experience. So that now you go back to your company or to your, whatever your job was, you know, outside the conference, and you have direct experience using the actual product that might be relevant to you and, or your company, right? And so you are much better situated to make decisions about whether or not this is a path you want to go forward for your team, if you've something you want to bring more investment into or not. That's hard to do with just a session. A session is kind of something that piques your interest and that lets you investigate further on your own, right? Whereas the hands-on lab really gets you closer to be able to make that decision. So that's absolutely how I see the two. Yeah.
And I think absolutely you're right. And be able to see and talk to the product owners, people that are involved in developing the tools. So what do you see as kind of some of the most exciting developments on the horizon for some of the Microsoft developer tools?
You know, I think it's funny enough, it's not some of the big things. I think it's the little things. I think it's the things that has come out of like what happens when you truly listen, what happens when you try to convert a user goal to a business goal instead of the other way around. And oftentimes those things, yes, sometimes they're big things. That's true. But oftentimes they are the little things, the paper cuts that we, you know, used to get every day, but we don't even recognize them anymore. Like getting rid of those, for instance. Something that helps us in the things we do every day. And a lot of these developer tools or data tools or any other is something that people use for 8 hours a day. And so I used to say that, you know, if you're using Visual Studio as an example here, you're using Visual Studio all day long. It's like you spend more time in Visual Studio than you do maybe at home sometimes, right? And so it is your second home. Like you spend like a third of your or half of your waking life using Visual Studio. So small things really, really matters. And so it's about listening. What are the small things that are important to you? What are the key things that can make you happier, more productive, more delighted? And I feel like that is where we have been neglecting for a little bit, at least in some areas. And I see that is where we get the most kind of applause at conferences when we do show some of these new smaller features that people have been asking for years that we finally get to do, right? And that is what seems to drive much more of the user satisfaction than any other thing that we do, funny enough, small things. So if I were to mention one thing, it would be small things.
Can you give us a hint or a lead in of what you think probably the most notable small thing is that you could potentially tell us about?
Oh, well, now we're talking about personal favorites at this point. I do have a personal favorite, which is something so basic that you might laugh when I tell you. But, you know, some of this software that we have is very old, like decades old, literally decades old. Like Visual Studio is 27, going on 28, right? Mm-hmm. And so there's just some baggage. There's some things that has always been in certain ways. And for some reason, we never changed it. And it's weird. And so one thing that we one thing that we changed recently was that when you have an error that shows up in the error list at the bottom of Visual Studio, normally when you copy, Control C to copy, it would copy the entire row, and that has different columns. So you couldn't just, it would have like line numbers, error message, file name, and different things that, you know, describing the error. And so you couldn't just take that and paste into Google to search for, hey, help me with this error. Mm-hmm. So we changed it. So now when you Control C to copy, it only copies the description. It's extremely small and basic, but it is probably my personal favorite of what we've been doing in the last few months. Something as small as that. And it's just the amount of feedback we've gotten from this has been so positive and so overwhelming that it's like, there's something here. There's something about something that happens when you really listen. I can tell from the team, like the pride, the motivation to keep going, to keep finding these things, to keep finding frustrating things, helping users, help support users, has skyrocketed because of it. And it's just little things like that.
But the little things are the big things, and you're absolutely right. Mm-hmm. The little paper cups, they add up, and at the end of the day, they take away our productivity as developers. So
yep.
Really appreciate that insight. So I have one last question for you. Tabs versus spaces.
This is the religious war. I don't want to start one of those. So I'm going to give you a vague answer.
Okay.
I personally use spaces because I do a lot of open source work on GitHub and stuff. And that seems to be the industry standard. I don't want to rock the boat. I don't want to have mixed spaces and tabs, right? We all been there and it's not nice. However, that's my programmer hat. When I take my tooling hat on, I like the idea of tabs because how big is a tab? Well, that depends on a setting or the tool. And so I feel like there's some flexibility in tabs as a indentation, just for the indentation, that allows for tooling that has yet to be fully explored. I think there's some hidden gems in tabs that we can do something about. But if everybody uses spaces, I don't know. Bill Gates apparently is on the record for being tabs over spaces.
Well, we'll start an internet controversy next.
I will stand right in the middle and say pros and cons on both sides.
Good answer. Mads, thank you so much for sharing all your insights and all your excitement around all of the stuff around Live 360 today. We cannot wait to see your keynote and learn so much more about building lovable software for millions of users. So for everyone tuning in, don't miss Live 360. It's going to be an incredible event filled with labs, sessions, and huge opportunities to network with folks around you and subject matter experts. So if you're a Visual Studio subscriber, don't forget that your subscription includes an exclusive discount for Visual Studio Live events. Now, that also includes Live 360. So you can find this benefit offer and all your benefits in the subscriptions portal at my.visualstudio.com. So thank you all for watching, and we'll see you at Live 360.